getting somebody else a rest. Hey, I don't mind if my son did not know.
Turn your attention to a few announcements before we get going this morning. First off, if you're visiting with us, we're delighted to have you come and worship God with us this morning. There is a blue card that I forgot to grab, but if I grab it, I'll be holding it right here in front of you in the pew. Thank you. And if you would just fill that out, we're not going to harass you. We're not going to, show up unannounced at your house for a party or anything, but we would just love to reach out to you, see if there's any more information we can get you, and that would be a great way. You can drop that in the offering plate. You can give it to the Welcome Center as you exit this morning, but we would appreciate your help with that. Similarly, if you are a member or have been here for a long time and you have not gotten into our new software, Breeze, there are forms, I understand, 2 or 3 months ago we were filling out. Those forms are also in the back of the Welcome Center. It'd be greatly appreciated if you got that. It's so important just to be able to communicate with the church. And if you didn't get emails from me this week, then you are not on that list. So I would ask that you please fill out one of those forms before you go today. Also in the back, there are sign-up forms. Alice is holding up for you there. These are forms to just give me some information on when a good time to meet with you is. My goal in the next, I don't know how long it's going to take, but roughly 3 months, is to sit down with everybody in the church in a one-on-one, one-on-two setting and just get to know you. And so if you would just fill that form out, it'll be a place for your name, a number, mid-morning, mid-afternoon, lunch, evening, breakfast, Sunday lunch, all kinds of times during the week, so that Miss Cindy and I in the office could schedule a time that I could be with you and your family. That would be very helpful, and I look forward to getting to meet you that way. A few other announcements that are in your bulletin. Tonight, we will not meet here, so do not come to Byron Baptist Church tonight. We will be at Bonaire First Baptist Church for my ordination service, and that's going to be a special time. We will have transportation from here if you want to ride. I think there's about 8 people signed up right now. It'd be good to know if you want in this morning so that we know if we're going to take the van or the bus. Mr. Robert Kendall has that list, so if you would see him before you leave today if you want to ride with some church folks over there. That van will leave at 5 o'clock today. Also, the Children in Action Mission Project, there are some rocks available at the Welcome Center for a donation, and that helps provide for the Global Baptist Response. So this is just a fundraiser for us as a church to send resources outside these walls to serve the world around us. And coming up next Sunday morning, there's a Brotherhood Breakfast. Not sure what the marketing on that was, but that is for everyone, even though it says Brotherhood Breakfast. So that's for everyone next Sunday morning at 8 a.m. It'll be my first one, and looking forward to being there with you. Two more things. The arrangements for Ms. Ansley Morris are 3 o'clock tomorrow here. We have a funeral, 1 o'clock when visitation will start. So if this is the first time you're hearing this, I'm sorry, but Ansley Morris, the daughter of Joya Marshall Morris, passed away this week. And so tomorrow, 1 o'clock here for visitation, 3 o'clock funeral, the burial will be private. And along with that, given that our church has lost 2 young ladies in their 20s in the last 2 months, I did make some changes to the bulletin this morning after the bulletin was printed. So a scripture reading will come from 1 Thessalonians 4, and I'll be preaching from John 11. This is not going to be a funeral service, but just given that we've lost 2 young ladies that close together, I felt like we needed to just be strengthened in some things that we can know about Jesus and how Jesus looks at death. So with that, I would love to call us to worship this morning from Psalm 34, verses 1 to 3. Hear God's word. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name.
When the nations God.
Though the world around us be shaken, our God's on His throne. His will be done. This is our Father's work. Would you stand with me as we sing that wonderful hymn, "This is my Father's"?
Altogether holy and just, and yet has found a way to justify sinners. We praise you as the one who saves sinners through a lamb who was slain. And Lord, corporately this morning, we confess our unbelief. We confess that we so often don't trust your ways. We don't trust that we can come before you. We don't trust that you care for our needs. We don't trust that you hear our prayers. Father, forgive us. We pray as the man pled to Jesus, "I believe, help me in my unbelief." And Lord, we give thanks to you that you do grant faith to your people. We give thanks to you that you do grant forgiveness for our sins. We give thanks to you that we can gather as a church, as people set apart for your kingdom work by your grace, as people brought from all walks of life to be a family, to walk together, to worship you, to serve one another, to come around the brokenhearted. Lord, we give you thanks for progress in our church family this week. We give you thanks for hearing our prayers from Mr. Barry Larson and how slowly but surely his body is being strengthened. We give you thanks for hearing our prayers for the Scotts and how Mr. Marshall and Ms. Mary Ann are back with us and getting stronger. And Lord, we come with our needs as well. Lord, outside these walls, we are thankful for Hardison Baptist Church, and we pray for their gospel work. We pray for Pastor Lance Buckless and his ministry there. We pray that you would bind up that church and give them unity and direction, and that they may enjoy worshiping you. Lord, down the street, we pray for Byron City Church. And I know nothing about Byron City Church, but I pray that it would be a place that exalts the name of Jesus. And I pray that it would be a place reaching this community, that the good news of Jesus may go out and that lives may be changed. And further away, up in Atlanta, we pray for Mount Vernon Baptist Church. And Lord, thank you for their gospel witness. Thank you for their investment in me and my family. Thank you for the dozens of people at Mount Vernon praying for Byron Baptist amidst these hard times. We pray that the gospel would go forth, that you would be exalted, and that many in the Atlanta area would know you through the ministry of Mount Vernon Baptist Church. Lord, you call us to pray for those leaders, those in authority over us. And so, Lord, this morning we pray for our local judges. God, we need a justice system that honors you. We need a justice system that truly brings justice. And so we pray for integrity. We pray for wisdom. We pray your blessings on our judges in this community. Father, for our church, we want to be a church of hospitality. Oh, grant us that we would be warm and gracious to people when they walk in these doors. Grant us that we would be warm and gracious to people far from these doors. May our homes be open. May our homes be beacons of light in this community as we welcome in the hurting and the broken sinners just like us that need a Savior just like us. Lord, help our church to be a church that serves one another. Help us to fill up these slots of serving in children's ministry and greeting and all the building needs and all the things going on week after week so that we can gather here each Lord's Day morning. Father, would you grant us that we would be servant-hearted? Father, we thank you that Christy Boutwell, surgery went well Friday, and she's ready to start chemo tomorrow. We pray your blessings on her and her family. We pray for your healing hand. We pray for wisdom for these doctors. We pray for grace and comfort for Christy and her family as she does this journey. And Father, we pray for our friends, the Morrises. We pray for Miss Betty and Mr. Jimmy, Miss Joya, Mr. Marshall. We pray for Nicholas and Ashley. We pray for DeLacy and Alex. We pray for their aunts and uncles and cousins and close friends, so many of which are in this room. Lord, we pray for your grace and your help and your strength. When Jesus left us, he promised a comforter, a helper. So, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, won't you bring comfort? Won't you bring grace? May we not mourn as those without hope. Lord, grant that we would mourn as followers of Jesus, trusting that you have healed our sister's body. Encourage our hearts as we lift our voices in prayer and song, and especially, Lord, as we look at your word. Oh, help us to hold fast to your truth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Change
in
the
scripture reading for this morning. I'm going to have us turn in just a moment to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And in 21st century America, death is so far from us. We think of it, particularly young people think of it, so infrequently. And this is a recent phenomenon because for thousands of years, people were surrounded by untimely deaths. But with modern medicine and safety, we've been able to distance ourselves from this reality. But it doesn't take away the sting. The Apostle Paul dealt with this reality as well, and he gave a word to his church in Thessalonica. And Miss Connie is going to come and read from 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 to 18. And I want to go ahead and tell you what verse 18 says so that you'll have this on your mind as she reads it. 1 Thessalonians 4:18 says, Paul summarizes, therefore, encourage one another with these words.
Church, it's a privilege this morning to read this scripture. And if you will, please stand with me if you can, and have your hearts and minds on our scripture. 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep, or grieve like the rest of the men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we are still alive and that we are left until the coming of the Lord, and will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from the heavens in a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of the God, and in the dead Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so that we will be with the Lord forever. Verse 18. Therefore, encourage each other with these words. Thank you.
This morning, as we continue to sing, we're going to sing a song called I Sing the Mighty Power of God. A God who is powerful to raise the dead. A God who is powerful to create our world. A God who is powerful to listen to his hands. Celebrate that with us this morning.
Thank you. Let us pray. Our Father, we come before you this morning with heavy hearts. Father, we just today ask that you provide your comfort among Marshall and Joy Mars for the loss of Ashley and the lives and all of the families involved. Uplift them to you. You can give them comfort that no one else can. We just ask you to do that this morning. We ask that you be with this church, Father, as we have a new pastor here to lead him, to lead us, Father, to glorify you and bring the people from outside into the fold, Father, that you will be glorified when that happens. Not if it's going to happen, but when it happens, Father. Just praise you for who you are and what you do, and because you first loved us, Father. You sent your Son to die on the cross, Father, that go through that horrible death and have everlasting life. Thank you for all these blessings each and every day that you give us, Father. And now we, Father, ask that you take these tithes and offerings we're about to receive. Bless the gift of the gift. Ask that you forgive us what we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You give life, you are love.
Thank you for these little blessings. to these families and to this church family. And Lord, as they go, we pray that they would know that it is you who puts breath in our lungs. We pray that your word would be a light unto their feet and a lamp unto their path. We pray it in Jesus' name. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to John chapter 11. As I stood in the Peach County Hospital on Thursday and later in the medical center, I was acutely aware of the sermon that I preached here 7 days ago about this God on his throne, all resources, all power. And I thought what many of you felt, God, why not? I know you can heal. I know it's not a lack of resources. And we knew about the Lamb too, the Lamb who ascended the throne and took the scroll. And so I know it's not a lack of love. Why, God? As I mentioned earlier, I felt in light of two untimely deaths in our church in 2 months that we would dig into John 11 this morning and just see what we could be reminded of. I'm not here to give you answers. I can't give you answers. But I can ground you in the truth of God's word and refresh you in God's love for his people and his ability to heal his people. And the message really hasn't changed. Because as we're going to see, when Jesus chooses to go to Bethany, where Lazarus, his friend, has died, and where his sisters are mourning, Jesus is ultimately laying down his life for his people. Because in going to Bethany, this is going to be one of the final turning points in his story where the religious leaders say, enough, he has to die. And so Jesus is going to go to Bethany. He's been off in the wilderness. He's been all laying low doing his ministry. And now he's coming right back. The scriptures tell us less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. He's coming back into the teeth of his enemies. And in delivering this one from death, he is going to lay down his life. That's the God we worship. John, so far in his gospel leading up to chapter 11, has presented Jesus as the bread of life, as the life-giving water, as the light of life, and now Jesus himself will give life. Typically, I would read the full scripture, and then we would work our way back through it. I'm going to do it a little differently today. We're going to work our way through it, verses 1 to 44, and then I'm going to have 5 points of application, all things about Jesus regarding death that I want us to take away from the text, and I'll point us back to those things. So I'm just going to begin in verse 1, and I'll add commentary as we work our way through this scripture. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment, wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. So as I already mentioned, Lazarus and his family are in Bethany, just outside of Jerusalem, and news comes, or Mary and Martha know they need to get news to Jesus, and so they send out word so that Jesus may come. They know that Jesus loves, we see verse 3, they know Jesus loves Lazarus, and they know that Jesus is able to heal. He's able to do great things. And Jesus' response is that it does not lead to death. Before Jesus even gets on the scene, Lazarus has died. He says it's for the glory of God. Jesus' end game here for Lazarus and for every one of us is not that we would stay alive in the flesh. That is not his highest aim. God's glory may sound cold here, because Lazarus in fact does die, and Jesus said, it's for the glory of God. That, it may sound like God has some sick, twisted thing going on, but we see immediately in verse 5 that is not the case. He's been identified in verse 3 as the one Jesus loves, and in verse 5 we learn that Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So it's not cold-heartedness that we're looking at here. Well, I want to tell you this morning that when the Holy Spirit inspired for this story, this account of Jesus' miracle to be recorded, he knew people in God's family for generations would need this testimony, would need to know how our Savior interacts with death. Because for generations, people in God's family have had untimely deaths as part of the curse of sin. So Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus. Verse 6, so when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Think about so many of us crying out on Thursday. Much like it back in December. And here Jesus is. He loves them. He loves them personally. It's not just God on high loving his creatures. This is three people Jesus personally loved. And when he hears the news, he stays 2 more days. Remember verse 4. It's for the glory of God. Then after this, he said to his disciples, let's go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, or teacher, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. You're going there again? The disciples know what's going on. The disciples know how this is likely to unfold. Jesus' delay shows that he is refusing to be manipulated. He is waiting on his Father's instruction. Jesus is about glorifying his Father, and he trusts, even with his friend, that his Father is working good. And in waiting, in delaying, and then also in walking into the teeth of those who wanted him dead, Jesus is confirming the faith of his followers. They knew he was a healer. They all knew he could heal the blind. They knew that the crippled could walk. They knew Lazarus could be healed from this illness. But that wasn't enough for Jesus and the Father. His followers needed to know something more about Jesus. Yeah, bread of life. Yeah, light of life. Oh yeah, resurrection. He is the resurrection. So the disciples are scared, and Jesus answers in verse 9. Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him. So the disciples are scared, and Jesus' response is, it's still daylight. And it's more than a day's journey. He's not talking about where the sun is. He's talking about the Father has still given him a window of time. His 12 hours, so to speak, of his public ministry, it's still light. And as long as the Father wants it to be light, he will continue to do the Father's will. Jesus knows a day of darkness is coming. Jesus knows he'll no longer walk this earth with his disciples. But Jesus isn't afraid, because it's still light. The Father has work for him to do still. The Father will provide. Verse 11. After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to waken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. But again, the disciples are right, insofar as they know. Yeah, I guess even 2,000 years ago, the best thing you can do for illness was sleep. And so, yes, Lord, let him sleep. We don't need to go risk our lives to go back near Jerusalem. Let him sleep, and he'll get better. Verse 13, now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake, I am glad that I was not there so that you may believe, but let us go to him. We're moving now from a healer, from a rabbi, from a teacher, from one who has unusual power and wisdom and unusual prayer life to more revelation, to more of who Jesus really is. Verse 16. So Thomas called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us go also that we may die with him. I don't know if Thomas was a bad dude as he gets a rap in the Gospels, but we don't get a lot of bright spots for old Thomas, but he's saying what they're feeling. They are like, this is a death trap. This is going back towards Jerusalem. There's Mary and Martha and Lazarus from this text are apparently influential people. Many Jews had already come out of Jerusalem to mourn with them, so we are just walking right into a trap. Of course, Jesus is not worried. Verse 17. Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So Jesus waits the 2 days, but by the time he gets there, he's already been dead 4 days. And there's some understanding of customs of the day where people in that culture believe that when you died, your spirit may hover for 3 days near you so that if your body, I guess, showed signs of life, your spirit could come back and you could be raised. And so this 4 days is significant in that this is very clearly a dead man, as we will see later in the text as well. I've already mentioned where they're at is about 2 miles from the big city of Jerusalem, and there are many Jews there. Many have come to comfort this family. Verse 20, when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. So Mary knows the same thing the disciples know. They know Jesus could have handled this. Jesus, you could have been here and you could have raised my brother from his sick bed. And then Martha seems to point to a little bit more faith when she says, but even now I know whatever you ask from God, God will give you. So Martha knows more. I don't know how fully she knows, because her faith will waver later in our passage when Jesus says, take the stone away, and she's like, God, his body will already stink. But maybe that's for us too. Like, Martha believed, but she's still struggling. Maybe that's where you're at this morning. Lord, I know you can do it, but I'm really struggling with this one. I'm really struggling with the brokenness. I'm really struggling with how you are powerful and good, and yet this prayer went unanswered. Jesus responds in verse 23, your brother will rise again. It's a beautiful ambiguity. As a good Jewish woman, she would have known that he was going to rise again on the last day. And Jesus is totally unclear and what he, as the story unfolds anyway, and what he means by this statement. It's true, but he's not clear as to whether he means in a few minutes or at the end of time. She responds, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And then the point of Jesus' waiting, then the point of the Father's control of this situation, the point for the disciples to see, for the Jews gathered around, to learn a little bit more about this rabbi. Verse 25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? When Jesus says that he is the resurrection and the life, this is a move from an abstract belief in a future resurrection to a concrete belief in a real Savior. Jesus is saying, yeah, you don't just have to look at the scriptures anymore and know that one day the dead will rise again. You can look at me. I'm the resurrection and the life. Jesus, the one, as the author of Hebrews tells us, holds the universe together by the word of his power. Jesus, the one we learn in the first chapter of John, who speaks it all into being. This Jesus identifies himself as the resurrection and the life. He feeds the hungry. He is the bread of life. He resurrects the dead. He is the resurrection. And he makes this plea, and this plea was as true then, is as true today as it was then. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. This is the invitation of the Christian gospel. This is what we hold fast to, that our Jesus lived a sinless life and died a sinner's death in our place, because we as sinners deserve to die and deserved to be separated from God forever. Jesus bore the wrath. Jesus bore the curse. And this Jesus, who had the ability to raise a dead man from a tomb after 4 days, will one day raise all those who are in Christ. And in the meantime, the Apostle Paul tells us, to be absent from the body is to be present from the Lord. So those friends that we've lost who are in Christ right now are in his presence in the Spirit. Their spirit is in his presence. And one day there will be a bodily resurrection, and they will have a glorified body like our Lord Jesus does. If you want to flip back a couple of pages in your Bible to John chapter 6, he says it another way here and unpacks it a little more. John chapter 6, verse 38 to 40. Jesus explains his mission. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will. Think about his will now. Think about if the friend you love is sick. You're going. You know, Jesus waits 2 days because the Father's got more at play here than what his disciples can see. Not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. Friends, if you are in Christ, you are in good hands. You cannot be lost. It doesn't matter what happens to your body. It doesn't matter. Every single person in this room, I dare say, has something wrong with your body. Our bodies are failing us. It's really miraculous every day that we stay alive because of all the amazing things that are happening in our body so that we can think and so that our heart keeps beating and we can talk and we can move our hands. It is really something to behold. But it doesn't matter if and when that fails, because this Jesus holds you. And if the Father has said, yes, this one, this Jesus will not let go, he continues, for this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life. And I will raise him up on the last day. Everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him. Have you done that today? Have you looked on this Son? There is no other way that you want to go to the ICU. There is no other way you want to get on these dangerous roads today unless you've looked on this Son. Family, I think about when we got called back after she passed Thursday night. Outside of her being with Jesus, there was nothing for that family. Nothing. And I don't want to try to emotionally drag you into some kind of relationship with Jesus, but I do want you to think, because we don't think about death. And it is going to happen. If Jesus tarries, we will all die. And there is no hope but that God will rescue our souls. Your sin is a big problem. My sin is a big problem. And it took a big Savior entering in to redeem us from that curse. Do not leave here, friends, unless you have looked on this Jesus. Looked on this Jesus who entered into our brokenness. He is not a foreign God. He lived it. As we'll see in a minute, he wept. He dealt with loss. He dealt with pain. He was betrayed. He was tried in an unjust court. He lived it. Martha's response in verse 27, back in chapter 11 now. She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." Bullseye. That's where we're trying to get. This is not some powerful rabbi. This is not some great teacher. This is the Christ, the promised one, the Messiah, the one who's coming to reverse the curse, the one who's coming to do what Adam couldn't do in the garden. This is Jesus. So, scene moves on. Verse 28, when she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. So, just to give you a little picture of what's going on here, Jewish custom of the day required that even a poor family hire two flute players and a professional wailing woman in this scenario. So when someone's died, you had to hire two flute players and a professional wailing woman to come and just help with the mourning process. And this appears to be a wealthy family, so there's no telling what this scene's like. So this entourage of mourners joins Mary going out to find Jesus. Verse 32, now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Sound familiar? It's exactly what Martha had said shortly above. It's the same message. They knew that he could heal. They didn't know he was the resurrection and the life. And by God's grace, this story is recorded for us today so that we can know that he is the resurrection. Verse 33. When Jesus saw her, that is Mary, weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and greatly troubled. Jesus sees the scene, and my ESV Bible, as well as the NIV, says he was deeply moved. My scripture copy is footnoted there. In the footnote, another translation for deeply moved, the bottom is indignant. He was indignant in his spirit. D.A. Carson is one of the great New Testament scholars living, and his comment on this verse, he translates that Jesus was outraged in spirit and troubled. It's a hard word, it doesn't come up a lot. It's my understanding in the New Testament, but this. So Carson and other scholars have gone outside the scriptures to try and figure out what this word is. What was Jesus feeling? And the word outside the scriptures in ancient Greek is used about the snorting of horses. Just that. I'm not going to do it for you. But that, you know that sound, the snorting of horses. That's what Jesus is feeling. He sees the weeping. He sees the brokenness. He sees the pain. This is the pain that he's entered in. And his response is outrage. Is being indignant, not with the mourners, but with death. Jesus knows that God himself had created a good world and that mankind rebelled against God. And when we rebel, we brought in the consequence of sin, which is death. And so Jesus, this is his friend, but this is also all of human history marred by sin and death, and he is indignant at what is happening here, and he's indignant about the hopelessness of the situation. Jesus is outraged with death itself. Verse 34, and he said, "Where have you laid him? Where is Lazarus?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Verse 35, Jesus wept. I remember being an RA 25 years ago, and you know, you got a sticker for every verse you memorized. And when I found out that was John 11:35, I was like, I'm in good shape on that one. And yet it gives us a glimpse into our Savior. He left the glory of heaven and he came down to earth and he became friends, seemingly largely with a bunch of guys that he could have done better, okay? And he was surrounded by these relationships, and the people that he loved were hurting and ultimately dying. This God who took home flesh wept. Oh, this God. Oh, this Jesus. He wept. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying? Truly. He's a great rabbi, remember? He's a great teacher. He's powerful. Verse 38, then Jesus, deeply moved, again, same word, came to the tomb. It was a cave and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, and we've just seen had so much faith, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he's been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? They responded in faith. 41, they took away the stone. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around me, that they may believe that you sent me. Father, this isn't about making bread for 5,000. This isn't about causing a blind person to be able to see for a few decades. This isn't about making someone stop bleeding. This is about resurrection life. This is about life eternal. This is not decades. This is millennia. Verse 43, when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And as all do, even when dead, when the Son of God calls them to come out, verse 44, the man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face unwrapped to be wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. See, Lazarus rose in this mortal life. Lazarus obeyed the voice of the living God. Even while dead, he had to obey. He came forth. This is a picture of what will happen one day when Jesus will call forth all of his own. Remember, he will not lose any the Father has given him. Jesus' own resurrection was a foretaste. It was the first fruits of what will take place. So we'll talk about that more in a minute. But this is pointing to a greater resurrection. So in our closing minutes this morning, I want to give you 5 things, and they'll be on the screen one at a time, about Jesus that we can take away from this text. I told you earlier, I can't give you answers. I can't. But I can tell you about this Jesus. I can tell you about this Jesus who entered in. I can tell you about this Jesus who pays the price for sinners like Kimberly and like Ansley and like Bill and like any of you who would put your faith and trust in him. First, we see throughout this text, Jesus' love is evident. Jesus' love is evident. If you have your scriptures, you can flip through with me. Start back in verse 3. I've already mentioned this. Lazarus is identified. Lord, he whom you love is ill. They didn't tell him the name. He just said, hey, here's the message. The one you love is ill. Verse 5, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Skipping ahead to verse 36, even the onlookers could see. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. His reaction showed his love for his friend Lazarus. And then verse 38, then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. Deeply moved again. He knew what was about to happen. And yet the brokenness and the sin and the death in this world grieved him, made him indignant at what mankind's rebellion had done to God's good creation. Jesus' love is evident. We need to know that. We need to know that when we're hurting. That he gave us the story. He lost his own friend. He loved. It was to give us an idea of who this Jesus is. What kind of love this Jesus has. Secondly, Jesus' purposes are bigger than we can see. Jesus' purposes are bigger than we can see. Start back with me in verse 4. This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Remember, at some point, Jesus has to go from rabbi, teacher, to crucified Savior. And this story is one of the linchpins in that unfolding journey where they say, oh, this is more. A healing ministry doesn't raise dead men. And Jesus goes into a dangerous place to raise his friend from the dead, ultimately leading to his own death. Verse 6. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. I still can't get into that. His friend is dying. His friend, the ladies that his friend's with are hurting. Jesus stays 2 days more. We have to put ourselves in Mary and Martha's shoes a little bit here and be like, Jesus, don't you love us? And the resounding answer of the scriptures is yes. And as you and I read this story, we're like, Mary and Martha, don't you believe? I think in heaven right now, Mary and Martha are like, Byron Baptist, don't you believe? His purposes are bigger than we can see. He doesn't make it easy, but his purposes are bigger than we can see. You see it in verses 9 and 10 as he chooses to continue to walk in the light as long as the Father gives him light to walk in. We see it in verses 14 and 15. Lazarus has died, and for your sake, I am glad I was not there so that you may believe. You need to know more than that Jesus was a good teacher. Verse 27. Martha's confession. She learns that Jesus is the resurrection of the life, and she says, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God. 41 and 42. Jesus' prayer shows that there's more going on than we can see. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around that they may believe that you sent me. This God is one. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one, working to accomplish God's glory and our good. Jesus' purposes are bigger than we can see. As we try to witness into these scriptures, Mary and Martha, believe. So the scriptures witness to us. Believe. Believe. Third, Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Beginning back in verse 11, after saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. Oh, how rich an awakening that would be. Verse 23, Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha states her good theology. And then Jesus goes, well, actually, I am the resurrection and the life. It's me, Martha. The one who raises the dead is the resurrection and the life. And I think the application of this reality that Jesus is the resurrection and the life is we don't have to talk abstractly about heaven. We say a lot of things as we mourn the loss about what they're doing and what they're not doing. And quite frankly, we don't know what they're doing and not doing. But we know that they're in the presence of the resurrection and the life. And we know that there is no joy unfilled. Psalm 16:11 speaks to God and says, in your presence there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. So I don't know. I don't know if your friend's playing golf. I don't know if your friend's eating food they always wanted to eat. I don't know, but I know that in God's presence there is pleasures forevermore. And I know that we get it because Jesus earned it. It's not the good things we've done. This Jesus lived a perfect life and died in our place. and he is the resurrection and the life. Fourth, Jesus knows bitter grief. Jesus knows what it is to have bitter grief. We've already seen this, but verse 33, he was deeply moved, he was indignant, he was outraged in his spirit and greatly troubled. 35, he wept. 38, deeply moved again. Jesus knows our bitter grief. He knows when he can't stand up here and make announcements without crying. I've only known her 10 days. He knows your bitter grief. And there's a grief and an outrage here. And I want you to hold on to both. There's grief and just, I don't know what to do with this. And there's outrage at sin and death. And those go together. That's proper mourning. You should hurt. More so, not just in a, I'm really sad. But there, if you have some bitterness in your heart that someone has died, that is good. That is what Jesus experienced. And so we come at this, and we're sad, and we're mad, and they come together in this grief that Jesus experiences. Deeply moved, greatly troubled, weeping. Our Jesus was perfect, and that was his response to death. So if you find yourself hurting this morning, you're in good company. It's a right response to death. It wasn't meant to be this way. Jesus knows better, bitter grief. Last, Jesus demonstrates a taste of what is to come. I've already read 41 and 42 again, where he prays. Verse 43, when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And the man who had died came out. His hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. This resurrection points to a greater resurrection. Because a few chapters later in the same gospel, we will find that Jesus too went to a tomb. That Jesus laid down his life so that sinners can be in a right relationship with God. And this, Jesus goes to a tomb, but he comes out different. Jesus doesn't come out in the grave clothes. You see, Lazarus comes out for a few years or a few decades, and he's going back in with more grave clothes. Jesus comes out glorified, glorified body, going to spend some 40 days, and then going to go be at the right hand of God the Father. He doesn't need grave clothes. They are, the scriptures tell us, they are left in the grave. It's a different resurrection. And that's the resurrection that you and I, in Christ, will see one day. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Our loved ones who have followed Jesus, who've trusted him with their sins, who've trusted them with their righteousness, they are in the presence of the Lord. One day he will come back and he will raise these pathetic little bodies into glorified bodies. And this gives us a taste of what's going to happen when he speaks forth and dead bodies come out. But there's a greater resurrection, and you have to know the greater resurrection, and that is our Lord Jesus Christ. This resurrection, Lazarus' resurrection, is a great story, but it does us no good. Because with just Lazarus' resurrection, we are still in our sin. But one paid the price for our sins, and he went into the grave, and he came out proving that he had vindicated the wrath of God, that he had satisfied the wrath of God, that the price was paid, that he was an innocent man dying for others, and he suffered the wrath that you and I deserve. When he comes out, there's no grave clothes, and his resurrection is a foretaste of the resurrection that you and I look forward to one day. You see, as we hurt right now, based on Angelie's profession of faith and based on the testimony I've heard from so many, she doesn't want to come back. This is not a good deal for Lazarus. He's got to come back to this broken place. It would not be a good deal for Angelie. She's with the Lord. She's with her Maker. She's with the one who loves her, the one who knit her and formed her in her mother's womb, the one who knew that she would have mono and that she would have all these little things breaking down her body. We look forward to a greater resurrection. We can look forward to it in Christ. And we can hurt. Jesus hurt. So hurt well in the coming days. But know that sin is the enemy. The wages of sin is death. And this, just in your own personal sanctification, hate the sin in your life. Sin is the problem. There's a risen Savior. If you're in here today and you haven't been in a right relationship with this risen Savior, I would again ask you, before you go back on these wet roads, before, I'm not trying to manipulate you, but I want you to think, because you don't think about death. And it's the most certain thing in your life. This Jesus invites you to come and be a part of his family. I said earlier, there are pleasures forevermore. It's not because we earn them. It's because Jesus earned them and said, come and share. Come and take my inheritance. So if you're in here today and you've never said, Jesus, I want you to be the Lord of my life and I want you to take away my sins, I would invite you to come find me as we sing in a moment. Find me after we dismiss in a few minutes. Or find somebody in this room you trust and say, tell me about this Jesus. You can say it more awkward than that. You can say whatever you want. We want to tell you about this Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we are so very grateful that you did not leave us to our own devices, that you did not leave us in our sins, but that you promised that one day a Messiah would come and he would crush the head of the serpent. And Lord, even in our sin, while we were still your enemies, you loved us. And we are so grateful this morning. Oh great God, would you work in our hearts, not for immediate healing. We need not be healed right away. We can hurt for a while. But may we hurt with hope. May we hurt with grace. May we know that Jesus Christ himself is the resurrection and the life. And may that change everything about our lives. Pray in Jesus' name.
Lay down your hands.
Just by way of reminder, there's a few things at the Welcome Center. If one of them stuck out to you during announcements this morning, you need to take care of, that's there. If you want to talk more about Jesus, or many people in this room would love to talk to you more about him. Hear this good word of the Lord as you go from 2 Thessalonians 2:16 and 17. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word.